Bondi Beach could be set to have its first summer without shark nets since World War II. Waverley Council advocating for change.
We're now in the 21st century, so I think we can do a whole lot better now.
This, as new data reveals, of the 228 animals caught in New South Wales nets in the past year, just 24 were target sharks. The other 204, innocent animals. Among them, turtles, dolphins and seals. More than half of all the creatures caught in nets dying as a result.
We're dealing with much-loved, iconic marine animals that are being caught and killed by these nets.
Over a quarter of them are threatened or protected under Australian law.
In the last 10 years, shark nets have caught over 3,600 animals.
The nets across New South Wales are due to go up next month for the summer season.
We are ready to install the nets if that is the decision that we make.
Beachgoers torn over whether they're worth the cost to wildlife.
Pros and cons, I guess. I think they cause a lot of issues as well to other animals out there, which is a shame.
We really need a shark nets here.
I wouldn't feel comfortable at all, not at all, if there weren't nets.
The nets were first installed after a series of shark-related deaths in the 1920s. There have been no fatal attacks at Bondi since 1929.
Whilst shark nets may remain in certain areas, sharks can swim around and underneath them. So the positive step forward here would be looking towards more of those smarter technologies.
Nets are also controversial in Queensland and WA, but the New South Wales government is under pressure to ditch the deadly devices.
All the councils along the coast, we all need to come together and work on this together to find alternative methods of keeping our communities safe, our swimmers safe and our surfers safe, because I don't believe that shark nets do that.
Brett Connellan survived a shark attack in 2016 while surfing in New South Wales. Brett, you lost most of your left thigh in that shark attack, but I understand you personally are not in favour of shark nets. Why?
Yeah, it's so this is a funny thing, I guess, to put those two things together. It doesn't make sense to a lot of people. From the onset of the attack, I've always been in admiration of sharks. And that is, you know, it's a strange way to get this perspective, but going through that experience in the manner that I did is something that kind of just gave me a perspective on sharks and how they are in the water and how amazing they are as creatures that I think I would love to see sharks admired by everyone the way that I do.
Brett, that is an extraordinary thing to hear, given that you were in the jaws of a great white. What was that experience like for you?
It was scary. It was terrifying. There's many words I think people could come up with, you know, by themselves that describe it, from their preconceived notions of, you know, what they think attacks are meant to be like based on Jaws or whatever it is that they've watched. But really, it is a surreal experience. There's nothing that makes you look at life differently, you know, than that experience of not only being that close to death, but it's a position that we don't experience as humans, which is being part of the food chain. And I think there's something so raw about that just forces you to look at life differently.
And a great story to tell at the pub.
Yeah, it's impressive. God.
Right?
Eat 32, yeah, free beer off someone. Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, Brett, we've seen incredible footage this week of swimmers unaware that they're swimming right on top of sharks. Isn't that what happens without nets?
I think that's what a lot of people would think. There is definitely a misconception about what shark nets do. I think a lot of people think shark nets are this barrier that deflects sharks and keeps them on the other side of it, when in reality, what a shark net is it's just a big fishing net. I think it's no real surprise that, you know, it's not this barrier that separates us from the natural world, which is the ocean, which is where sharks are.
But it's pretty hard to argue with the results in Bondi, for example. So, you know, in the up to the 20s, there were lots of shark attacks, fatalities and injuries. Then they put the nets up in, I think it was the late 20s, and they've stopped. Just hasn't been one since. So, like, how do you argue with that sort of field evidence?
The thing about shark nets is they were introduced so long ago that they are now an ageing technology and an old technology, in fact. And it's, I guess, when it comes to this conversation about whether to keep the nets or to take the nets out, it's not necessarily taking the nets out and saying it's a free-for-all, you're all on your own now. When it comes to taking the nets out, it's about putting in new technologies and new strategies, which we now know have effectiveness to not only mitigate sharks, but to learn more about this species.
So there are new technology, like you mentioned. There's drones, there's tagging, the smart drum lines. I remember I used to have the drone app when I lived in the eastern suburb of Sydney, and you'd check it before you went out. What is the best method to make sure what happened to you doesn't happen to other people?
Yeah, it does really come down to education at the end of the day. For me, post-attack, one of the most important things that I did was to educate myself on what were some of the conditions that maybe led towards that attack. Was it the water temperature? Was it the sea life in the area around that time of year? Was it the time of day? And when we can make a fair assessment based on some of these factors by educating ourselves, we can then feel more comfortable making a decision whether we are okay with going in the water or maybe just hanging on the beach that afternoon or that evening, as some people may have argued that I should have done, and I would be three quarters of a leg better off because of that.
Brett, thanks so much for speaking to us tonight.
Thank you so much.